Welcome to EconTalk, part of the Library of Economics and Liberty. I'm your host, Russ Roberts of Stanford University's Hoover Institution. Our website is econtalk.org, where you can subscribe, comment on this podcast, and find links and other information related to today's conversation. You'll also find our archives, where you can listen to every episode we've ever done going back to 2006. Our email address is mail@econtalk.org. We'd love to hear from you. Today is September 16th, 2014, and my guest is Thomas Piketty, or as most Americans pronounce it, Thomas Piketty. We'll try to do our best to say it correctly. He is professor of economics at the Paris School of Economics and author of Capital in the 21st Century, the subject of this episode. Thomas, welcome to EconTalk.
Thank you for inviting me.
So your book, Capital in the 21st Century, is a remarkable book, and it's received a remarkable amount of attention. I don't think there is a book since Keynes's General Theory that has generated as much interest. So first, I want to say congratulations.
Thank you.
The book's an incredible collection of data, much of it done by you with various co-authors, and it's also a series of explanations for what is in the data. I want to start with what you consider the main empirical findings. What are they?
Okay. Well, there are really several important empirical findings because this is, first of all, a book about the history of income and wealth distribution in over 20 countries, over three centuries. So, you know, it couldn't be that this can be summarized with just one evolution or one mechanism. So there are many different forces, sometimes contradictory, that are going on. And I really first want to stress that the primary purpose of this book is to put together this vast quantity of historical data that I could never have collected on my own and that was collected with several dozen scholars, Tony Atkinson, Emmanuel Saez, Facundo Alvaredo, Gabriel Zucman, many scholars from many countries. And the primary purpose of the book is really to make this material accessible, to try to tell a story in plain language that allows everybody, and certainly not only economists, to access this historical material so that people can make their own mind about the future, about the explanation. And, you know, I certainly do not claim I have the ultimate explanation for everything. And, you know, we know a little bit more than we used to, but we still know far too little. So one of the key patterns and one of the key evolutions that I have learned about in this research is the following. We've seen in most developed countries an important reduction in inequality in the first half of the 20th century. And then starting somewhere in the 1970s or 1980s, depending on the country, we've seen an important rise in income and wealth inequality. And this reflects really different mechanisms, some that have to do with the inequality of labor income and some that have to do with the inequality of wealth. And both are important. To a large extent, what the book is trying to do is to shift the attention from the inequality of labor income to the inequality of wealth, which in the very long run might be even more important. But really, both evolutions are important and involve different mechanisms. So the rise in the inequality of labor income, which has been particularly strong in the United States and somewhat less strong in Europe and Japan, although you also find it there, is usually analyzed in terms of changing patterns for the supply and demand of skill, the impact of globalization, competition with emerging countries. And this is certainly part of the explanation. But one of the points I make in my book is that this cannot be the entire explanation because a very large part of the rise in labor income inequality, in fact, has to do with the very, very top incomes, you know, the rise of very top managerial compensation, the top 1% or sometimes even top 0.1%. Earnings, typically executives in very large corporations. And that's difficult to explain just on the basis of supply and demand for skills because it's not, you know, that the top 1% labor earners are a lot more educated than the next few percent. So it's, if you really want to explain it, and that's what I do in the book, using joint research with Emmanuel Saez and Stephanie Stancheva, you have to look at the transformation of the institution governing the pay setting process at the very top end of large corporations. And to summarize very quickly our conclusion, we feel that the theory of marginal productivity is a bit naive, at least for this top part of the labor market. That is to say, when a manager manages to get a pay increase from $1 million a year to $10 million a year, according to the textbook model based on marginal productivity, this should be due to the fact that his marginal contribution to the output of his company has risen from 1 to 10. Now, this is a bit naive. It could be that in practice, individual marginal productivities are very hard to observe and monitor, especially in a large corporation. And there is clearly a strong incentive for top managers to try to get as much as they can. And the change, very sharp change in the tax progressivity that has happened in the US since the 1970s, 1980s, has probably changed quite radically the incentives for top managers to try to do as much as they can to get this pay increase.
You're talking about
the right people.
You're talking about the reduction in marginal tax rates. And your argument in the book is that...
Right, exactly. So, yeah.
Your argument in the book is that this meant that if you could get a raise, you could keep more of it than you would before. This is the opposite of what standard economic theory would predict, which is decreases in marginal tax rates should actually lower pre-tax income but increase after-tax income. But you have a different model then of what determines pay.
Well, in the standard model, when you cut the marginal tax rate, people should react by working more, being more productive, and this should raise their income. Now, this is one possible channel, but what we find in the data is that there could be another channel, which is that simply you're going to bargain more aggressively for a bigger pay. So to be very concrete, when the top income tax rate in the United States between 1930 and 1980, which is a very long period of time, was on average 82% at the federal level. And you had periods where it was 91%, periods where it was 70%. On average, it was 82%. Now, when the top tax rate is 82%, of course, you always want to be paid $1 million more, but at the margin, when you get a pay increase of one extra $1 million, 82% is going to go straight to the treasury. So your incentives to bargain very aggressively and put the right people in the right compensation committee are going to be not so strong. And also, your shareholders, your subordinates maybe will tend to tell you, well, look, this is very costly. Whereas when the top tax rate goes down to 20-30% or even 40%, so you keep, 2/3 or 60% of the extra $1 million for you, then the incentives are very, very, very different. Now, this model seems to explain part of what we observe in the data. In particular, it's very difficult to see any improvement in the performance of managers who are getting $10 million instead of $1 million. When we've put together a database with all the publicly traded companies in North America, Europe, Japan, trying to compare the companies that are paying their managers $10 million instead of $1 million. And it's very difficult to see in the data any extra performance. And if anything, what you see is that the elasticity of top managerial pay with respect to profits of the company is actually higher for the variations in profits that have nothing to do with individual performance. So, for instance, when you have industry-wide changes in profits or shocks to terms of trade or other macro parameters that affect the profitability of your business, then the elasticity of the top managerial pay is even higher. So which really suggests that basically when you have more cash on the table, you tend to take it, particularly in countries and time periods where the tax rate is slower.
Now,
so
Stephen,
anyway, that's one of the mechanisms account for this.
Yeah. Let me ask you about that. Stephen Kaplan, who was a guest on EconTalk a while back, in his work with Joshua Rao on the top 1%, they argue that because the gains are very similar in the top 1% across sectors, so that the corporate sector does get higher pay, but so do the non-corporate sector, lawyers, athletes, and others in the top 1% have similar increases, that it's hard to believe that it's corporate governance, the failure of corporate governance to bargain appropriately with top managers. What do you think of their work?
Well, I think the top managers are in fact a much, much bigger fraction of the top 1% and top 0.1% than athletes and movie stars and such professions. So in fact, no, I do believe that most of the action comes from top executives in large corporations. I think one reason why Kaplan and his co-authors don't see it that way is that they only count, the top five earners in large corporations. But in large corporations, it's actually a lot more than five people in each corporation that are making it to the top 1%. Or even to the top 0.1%. So they don't have the data because they only use publicly released data on top five earners in each corporation. But if you use a tax return file where you have the entire universe of income earners and wage earners in the US, then in fact you can see that top executive broadly defined, all those that make, if you want to be to the top 1%, you need to make more than, $400,000 or $500,000. If you want to make it to the top 0.1, $1 million, $1.5 million, depending on which year you look at. But if you take such thresholds, then you will see that top executives in large corporations are indeed driving the process. I think another limitation in the data they're using is that they basically only look at the U.S. So, I think the U.S. is it's a very interesting country, of course, but I think the rest of the world is interesting also. And in order to understand what are the true reasons for what we observe, I think that the cross-country perspective is important because it's very difficult to explain, one reason why it's so difficult to explain the data simply with a skill-based or talent-based story is that it's hard to understand why it would happen so much in the U.S. and much less in Germany or Japan or Sweden.
One explanation would be that combined with globalization, U.S. corporations tend to be larger, and there have been studies that find that there's a correlation between compensation and size of firm.
Well, no. If you look at international data and you control for size, that's you still have the main part is left unexplained. So the main part of the extra inequality that you find in the U.S. is left unexplained. So this is what we do in a paper with Emmanuel Saez and Stephanie Stancheva that was published in the American Economic Journal earlier this year in 2014. And as far as I know, this is the first paper, taking a cross-country perspective on top pay setting. And we do have control for firm size. We do have control for industry. So, it's not that you have bigger companies in the U.S. It's not that you have more financial companies in the U.S. or in the U.K. that's going to be enough to explain the particularly strong rise in inequality in those two countries, particularly in the U.S. We put this control in the regression, and what we find is that what matters much more is the change in the top tax rate over time in these different countries. But I think this cross-country analysis is more complete than other analyses of this sort, but I certainly do not claim that this is the final word. And I think the supply and demand for skills explanation, globalization explanation also matters. You know, I think we don't have to choose between the two. I think the two are important. I just think that for the very top end, institutional forces are probably even more important.
Well, we'll come back to this because I want to come back to the United States in particular and the labor inequality, but I want to make sure we get to the wealth inequality issues. You write that R greater than G is the central contradiction of capitalism. Explain what R and G are and why their relative size is important, because that's really one of the central themes of the book that runs through the entire book.
Right. So my book is trying, as I said, to shift attention from rising inequality of labor income to rising wealth inequality. And indeed, in order to analyze the long-run evolution of wealth concentration, there is one central force that I emphasize, which is the tendency of the rate of return to capital to exceed the economy's growth rate. So what are we talking about? So R is the rate of return on capital, which is, you know, how much, what is the return that you get during 1 year on your capital investment? So, you know, the easiest form of capital holding will be, you know, imagine you own an apartment or house worth $1 million. What's going to be the rental value during 1 year? So if the rental value is $40,000 during a year, then that will be a return of 4%. Now, when you invest your money on the stock market, and which is typically a more risky investment than housing, the return in the long run is typically bigger than that. You know, it could be 6%, 7%. So, of course, it's very volatile across assets. It's not the same for the different assets, but typically it can be 4%, 5% or more for more risky investment. The growth rate of the economy, it's a completely different concept. The growth rate of the economy in the long run reflects first the growth rate of population, so how much population is increasing, and next the growth rate of productivity. So this is the growth rate of per capita GDP, how much the output per inhabitant is rising due to the rise of productivity, technical knowledge. So the growth rate of the economy is determined both by demographic forces, by innovation, and of course these forces have not much to do with the forces that determine the rate of return to capital, which are primarily how useful capital is for production, and there's really no reason why R and G should be equal. And in practice, what we observe, and we can talk a lot more about why we observe this, is that in the long run, there is a tendency for R to exceed G, which means something very concrete. So let's take an example. Assume R is 5% per year and G is 1%. What does this mean? Well, this means that if you own a lot of wealth to begin with, then you can consume 4/5 of the return to your capital, and you can reinvest only 1/5 of the return, so 20%, and this will be enough to ensure that your wealth will rise at the same speed as the size of the economy. So this is a very nice situation, you know, for initial owners of wealth, in the sense that you can sustain high living standards, reinvest only a small part of your income, and still your wealth and the wealth of your family, of your successors, can rise as much. Now, that does not imply that inequality will rise to infinity, because people indeed will typically consume a big part of the return to their wealth.
Sometimes they will give always it away.
Sure. So there will always be some mobility in wealth because some people give it away. Some people have many children. Some people have too few children. Some people die too late. Some people die too soon. Some people make crazy investments. Some people make very good investments. So, you know, you will always have some mobility. But other things equal, a bigger gap between R and G will lead to an equilibrium distribution of wealth that is more unequal, and that will involve more reproduction over time of inequality. Okay, so the bigger R minus G, the more inequality, the less mobility. And Of course, there are many other forces that are important. You know, the saving behavior, are you going to give it away? The demographic behavior, do the rich have more children than the poor? How the financial markets operate? So, for instance, financial deregulation in recent decades has probably increased the inequality in rate of return for people with different wealth levels. You know, from the data we have and that I analyze in the book, for instance, for large university endowments, you know, it looks as if the bigger your endowments, the more you are able to access to sophisticated financial products, financial derivatives, etc., that give you sometimes a much bigger return than, you know, the typical middle class family that is sometimes getting pretty lousy return. So also, you know, the inequality in return around the average return is also going to play a big role. But taking all of these other factors as given, a bigger gap between the average rate of return and the economic growth rate will tend to lead to higher inequality. And what I argue in the book and what I have found using historical data is that this is probably one of the key forces explaining why historically wealth concentration has been so large in most societies and most civilizations. Actually, until World War One, if you take in particular most European countries, you have very, very large concentration of wealth well until World War One. And what I argue using the historical materials that I found, especially for France and Britain, is that the fact that the rate of return was bigger than the growth rate was pretty obvious during most of human history, simply because the growth rate was close to zero. So during most, until the Industrial Revolution, the population was almost stationary. Productivity was rising very, very, very slowly. So the total growth rate of GDP was less than 0.1 or 0.2% per year. So, of course, the rate of return was a lot larger than that. The typical rental value to land or to buildings will be at least 3% and generally 4 or 5%. So that's a lot bigger than 0.1%. And now, with the Industrial Revolution in the 19th century, you have, of course, a rise of the growth rate. But at the same time, the rate of return to capital is also rising somewhat because you have new investment opportunities, new forms of capital accumulation. So maybe, you know, growth rate goes from 0 to 1% in per capita terms, and the rate of return goes from 4, 5 to 5, 6, sometimes 7%. So at the end of the day, the gap between the two is not very strongly affected. And it's important to realize that the growth rate in the very long run is typically not 5%. You know, the only time in history where you observe a growth rate of 5% or above 5% are countries that are catching up with other countries. So typically, Germany or Japan or France in the post-war period are growing faster than 5% per year. But this is just because in 1945, you know, these countries have a very low GDP, so they had to catch up, in particular with the US. Or today, China is catching up with the rest of the world, so they have very fast growth rate. But when you are at the world technological frontier, there's no example of a country where per capita GDP growth is higher than, you know, maybe 1.5%. You know, so some people think it's even less than that in the very long run. In any case, there are reasons to believe that we might again have, in the 21st century, this inequality, at least in developed countries and maybe also in emerging countries, when they will have completed their catch-up process, we will have this inequality between R and G, together with the financial deregulation process that has increased inequality in R. This is one of the mechanisms that can contribute to explain relatively high and rising inequality of wealth.
Okay, so let me raise some issues I think are relevant. Now, first, It's clearly true that if I save all my income and I don't eat anything and I don't give any of it away and I have lots of children and I have one child, say, that one child will have gotten an enormous extra benefit from the fact that the parent can invest the money at R. That child will have an advantage over a wage earner who doesn't have any access to capital. It seems to me that in the 20th century, and some a little bit in the 21st, first there's an increased access to capital by the general public in the form of retirement plans and stock programs and low-priced opportunities to invest in equity, and particularly index mutual funds. And the real question, though, is why should I care? Let's talk philosophically. And by the way, the R you're talking about is risky, of course, the average rate. So it's not always true that the rich are able to just get this risk-free rate. It's not risk-free. But let's talk philosophically for a minute. Why should I? Mm-hmm. There are a lot of people who are wealthier than I am. A lot of them didn't earn it. Sam Walton, who founded Walmart, four of his either relatives or descendants are in the top 10 of the Forbes 400. They're four of the richest of the 10 richest Americans right now. Steve Jobs or his descendants, they're doing better than I am. They make a lot more. They have a lot more access to money than I do. Why? And there are people with less than I have. Why should I be concerned about that? In particular, do you see any role for the accumulation of capital to help people other than those who hold it? Is there any worry that your interest in reducing capital concentration could affect the growth rate? Because you don't seem to suggest any connection between the two. So there's a lot of questions there. Sorry. Take a shot at it.
Mm. Oh, yes, you've said so much, you know, I don't know where to start. But let me make clear that, you know, I love capital accumulation, and I certainly don't want to reduce capital accumulation. The problem is the concentration, okay? But so let me make very clear that inequality in itself is, of course, not a problem. You know, inequality can actually be useful for growth up to a point. The problem is when inequality of wealth and concentration of wealth gets too extreme, it is not useful anymore for growth. And it can even become bad because it leads to high perpetuation of inequality over time, so it can reduce social mobility. And it can also be bad for the working of our democratic institutions. So where is the tipping point? Where when is it that inequality becomes excessive? Well, I'm sorry to tell you that I don't have a mathematical formula for that. And all I have, all we have, collectively, is historical evidence. And all I do in my work, you know, is to try to put together a lot of historical evidence to see what we can learn about the location of the tipping point. So what can we learn about the location of the tipping point? Let me tell you a couple of things we can learn. First of all, you know, the kind of extreme concentration of wealth that we had in every European country until World War I, I think was not useful. It was excessive. So at that time, and you know, there was a lot more concentration than what we have today in Europe, and even more than what we have today in the US. Basically, there was almost no middle class. So the 90% of the wealth would belong to the top 10%. Now, was this useful for growth? There's very little evidence for this claim. If you look at the evidence we have, you know, you have a huge reduction in concentration following World War I, the Great Depression, World War II, also following the public policies, universal education, the welfare state, progressive taxation that were adopted following these shocks. Now, was this bad for growth? No, this was not bad for growth. If anything, growth in the post-war period has been higher than what it has ever been. And, you know, even today, although it is not great, it is of the same order of magnitude, or actually better than what we had in the 19th century, early 20th century. And the reason is simply that, you know, the middle class, the fact that we have a significant share of wealth that does not belong to the top 10% and that belongs to a broad middle class that have access to wealth is certainly not bad for growth. So inequality, you know, above a certain point is just not useful anymore. So I think, you know, we don't want to return to this kind of extreme form of inequality. I think at some abstract philosophical level, everybody agrees that inequality is acceptable as long as it is in the common interest, as long as it benefits the whole of society through more innovation, more growth. Now, right now, if you look at the data we have on wealth dynamics, one striking finding that I put forward in my book is that, first, I think what we need is, we need more transparency about wealth. You know, we know too little about wealth dynamics, and one of the reasons why I am in favor of a wealth tax, and we can talk more about that, is that this will produce more transparency, more data on wealth dynamics. But for now, we need to do with what we have, and what we have are typically Forbes ranking of wealth in the US or similar rankings in the rest of the world. Now, if you look at this data, what you find is the following. You know, over the past 30 years, if you start in 1987, which is when Forbes started producing their global wealth ranking, and you go until 2013, what you find is that the top wealth holders, so usually what people do is just to say, okay, you have more and more billionaires in the world, which in a growing world economy is not too surprising. So what I do is a little bit more sophisticated. You take a fixed fraction of the world population, and you have a rising world population, but you take a fixed percentage at the very top, and you look at the evolution of the average wealth of this group, and you compare to average growth of the world economy. So, of course, this group, as you mentioned very rightly, is not made of the same people. You know, there's a lot of mobility. You know, the world billionaires of 1987 and those of 2013 are not the same. But still, it's interesting to look at how the average wealth of this group is changing, because if we were in an equilibrium of the world distribution of wealth, in principle, you would have some mobility, some people go down, some people go up, but on average, the average wealth of this group should be rising approximately at the same speed as the size of the world economy. I'm not saying it should rise exactly at the same speed, but it should be comparable rate of growth. Now, this is not at all what you observe. So according to the data we have from Forbes Global Wealth Ranking, these very top groups have been rising at 6-7% per year over this period. Now, world GDP has been rising at 3-3.2% per year over this period, but in fact, half of it is due to population. So if you take per capita income at the world level and per capita wealth at the world level, it has been rising at 1.5-2% per year. So in other words, the top is rising 3-4 times faster than the average. Now, of course, this cannot continue forever. And I'm not saying this will continue forever. You can see that, if it was to continue forever, if the top was to rise 3-4 times faster than the size of the world economy forever, then, 30 years from now, you will have close to 100% of world wealth to a little group of billionaires. And some of them are U.S. billionaires. Some of them are Russian oligarchs. Some of them are, lots of people. And 100% will be too much. So I think you agree with me that this cannot continue forever. And actually, it will not continue forever. The question, you agree that you cannot have forever the top rising 3-4 times faster than the average. Even if you have mobility, even if these are not the same people, from a purely logical perspective, this cannot continue forever.
Right, but
you agree with that.
But the question is, what's the underlying causal mechanism? And just to take, let's take two examples, one of which is very mundane and one of which is not mundane. So the Waltons, who we talked about before, who were not there in 1987 but are there now, they changed retailing in the United States and probably in the world, and they made it easier. They figured out ways to deal with inventory and to control costs using technology.
Sure, you're right. I agree with you.
They made millions of people better off, and they got richer being in the top 1% than people before them.
I agree with you. There's no problem with that. But still,
They made the world a better place.
Can I ask you a question?
But do you agree that they made the world a better place?
Oh yeah, of course, much better place, and Bill Gates as well, and you have lots of entrepreneurs in the world which are extremely useful. Of course, who could deny that? But still, even if these people were all different entrepreneurs each year, and that are very useful for the world, do you agree that the average wealth of the top cannot go up forever 4 times faster than the size of the world economy?
I don't think that's the relevant question. The relevant question is...
No, but look, it's a very simple, logical question. And of course, so let me try
They can get an ever-increasing share. The fundamental question is, what's the value to the rest of us as they get an ever-increasing share? And if their increasing share is coming from an increase in technology and globalization, which is limited, that will slow down. The globalization will slow down. So the ability to capture large amounts of wealth relative to the past.
I think you are remarkably optimistic about natural forces, and this is great. You know, I love market forces as well, but I think at some point it's important to look at the numbers. And when a group is growing 3 to 4 times faster than the average, just simple logical computation will show you that in 30, 40 years, you know, the share of national wealth going to a very tiny group can get enormously high. So let's be concrete about what are the wealth shares. No, let's be very concrete. So let's take the U.S. Okay, in the U.S. right now, the bottom 50% of the population owns about 2% of national wealth, and the next 40% owns about 22% of national wealth. And this group, you know, the middle 40%, the people who are not in the bottom 50 and who are not in the top 10, they used to own 25 to 30% of national wealth, and this has been going down in recent decades, as was shown by a recent study by Saez and Zucman, and now this is closer to 22%. Now, how much should it be? You know, I don't know. I don't know. But the view that we need the middle class share to go down and down and down, and that this is not a problem as long as you have positive growth, I think is excessive. You know, I think we need entrepreneurs. And, you know, I'm not saying, look, if it was perfect equality, the bottom 50% should own 50% and the next 40% should own 40%. I am not saying that we should have this at all. I'm just saying that when you have 2% for the bottom 50 and 22 for the next 40, you know, the view that we cannot do better than that, otherwise you won't have entrepreneur anymore, you won't have growth anymore, is very ideological.
I don't dispute
and
that.
And also, it's not at all consistent with historical evidence we have, which is that some inequality is useful for growth. Look, you know, the problem is that the growth performance in recent decades of the U.S. economy and more generally of developed countries has not been particularly good. You know, if you look at per capita GDP in the U.S. between 1980 and 2010, you have 1.5%. So, you know, if it was a 5% growth rate, maybe it would be worth having, a declining middle class share. But if you have a 1.5% growth rate and the share going to the middle class and the bottom is reduced, then, you know, is this a good deal?
I'm only saying it's misleading to look at the share because I mostly care, about whether the well-being of people is increasing and not their particular share of the pie. The pie is getting
bigger. Well, I think a solid middle class, you know, is important for the economy and for the democracy. You know, I think the society, European societies, again, in the 19th century, it was less extreme in the U.S. at that time because of a growing population, new immigrants, so you had less of a big accumulation of family wealth for decades and decades. So it was less extreme in the U.S. But speaking from Europe, I can tell you that, you know, the kind of extreme concentration of wealth that you had in Europe until World War One. You know, it's not good, it's not useful for the economy when it is so extreme.
I agree.
It leads to perpetuation over time of inequalities, and it's not good for democracy. You know, I think a middle class having access to wealth and you know, showing that this is not contradictory with economic efficiency, you know, that's important for our society in general.
I don't disagree with any of that. Well, maybe not. I agree with most of that. I think it's perfectly legitimate to argue what I've tried to argue and then still believe that we should have a large tax. I'm not in favor of it, but I understand the point about incentives. The effects may be small. I'm just trying to get at the mechanics because I think it matters a lot for why inequality has risen. So, for example, if somebody has gotten wealthy because they've been able to be bailed out using my tax dollars, then I would resent that. But if somebody is wealthy because they've created something marvelous, I don't resent it. And I says, my argument is that when we look at the Forbes 400 or the top 1%, many of the people in there, their incomes have, their wealth has risen at a greater rate than the economy as a whole, not because they're exploiting people, not because of corporate governance, but because of an increase in globalization that allows people to capture, make more people happy, make more people, to provide more value. My favorite example is sports. Lionel Messi makes about three times, the great soccer player, the great footballer, makes about three times what Pele made at his best earning year 40 years ago. That's not because Messi is a better soccer player. He's not. Pele, I think, is probably a better soccer player. But Messi reaches more people because of the internet, because of technology and globalization. You can still argue that he doesn't need $65 million a year and you should tax him at high tax rates. But I think as economists, we should be careful about what the causal mechanism is. It matters a lot.
Oh, yes. But this is why my book is long, because I talk a lot about this mechanism. And you know, I talk a lot about entrepreneurs. And of course, there is a lot of entrepreneurial wealth around. But my point is certainly not to deny this. My point is twofold. First, even if it was 100% entrepreneurial wealth, you don't want forever to have the top growing four times faster than the average, even if it was mobility, complete mobility from one year to the other. You know, it's just, it cannot continue forever. Otherwise, the share of middle class in national wealth goes to 0%, and you know, 0% is really very small. So I think that would be too much. And point number two is that when you actually look at the dynamics of top wealth holders, you know, it's really a mixture of you have entrepreneurs, but you also have sons of entrepreneurs. You also have ex-entrepreneurs who don't work anymore, but their wealth is rising as fast and sometimes faster than when they were actually working. You have it's a very complicated dynamics. And also, you know, be careful with the Forbes ranking, which probably are even underestimating the rise of top wealth holders, and you know, they have a lot of problem counting for inherited diversified portfolios. You know, it's a lot easier to spot people who have created their own company and who actually want to be in the ranking, because usually they're quite proud of it, and maybe rightly so, than to spot the people, who just inherited from the wealth. And so I think, you know, this data source is very biased in the direction of entrepreneurial wealth. But, you know, even if you take it as perfect data, you will see that, you know, you have a lot of inherited wealth. You have I give this example in the book, which is quite striking. You know, the richest person in France, and actually one of the richest in Europe, is Liliane Bettencourt. Actually, her father was a great entrepreneur. Eugène Schuller founded L'Oréal, who is the number one cosmetics in the world. You know, they're doing lots of fancy products to have a nice hair. And, you know, this is very useful. This has improved the world welfare by a lot.
Nice.
The only problem is that Eugène Schuller created L'Oréal in 1909. And he died in the 1950s, and you know, she has never worked. And, you know, what's interesting is that her fortune, you know, between her wealth, between 1990 and 2010, has increased exactly as much as the one of Bill Gates. You know, she has gone from 5 to 30 billion dollars, when Bill Gates has gone from like 10 to 60. You know, it's exactly in the same proportion. And, you know, in a way, this is sad, because, of course, we would all love, Bill Gates' wealth to increase faster than that of Liliane. You know, look, why would I, you know, I'm not trying to, you know, I'm just trying to look at the data. And when you look at the data, you will see that the dynamics of wealth accumulation are not only about entrepreneurs and merit. And it's always a complicated mixture. And, you have oligarchs who are seated on a big pile of oil, which, I don't know how much of it is their labor and talent, but, you know, some of it is certainly direct appropriation. And once they are seated on this pile of wealth, you know, the rate of return that they are getting by paying tons of people to make the right investment with their portfolio can be quite impressive. So I think we need to look at these dynamics in an open manner. And, you know, when Warren Buffett says, I should not be paying less tax than my secretary, I think he has a valid point. And I think the issue that, the idea that we are going to solve this problem only by letting these people decide how much they want to give individually, is a bit naive. You know, I believe a lot in charitable giving, but I think, we also need collective rules and laws in order to determine how each one of us is contributing to tax revenue and the common good.
Well, the share contributed by the wealthy in the United States is relatively high. You could argue it should be higher. As you would point out, I don't really have a model to know what that amount would be. But even when the real question for me is the size of government. If there's a reason for it to be larger, if the money can be spent better by the government, that would be one thing. And again, the other question is what should be the ideal distribution of the tax burden. But let's talk a little bit about the middle class, because my real point about the Forbes 400 or wealthy entrepreneurs is that it is their contributions, their innovations that have made our lives better. And that's a good thing. And the fact that their income is growing faster, their wealth is growing faster than the average, is a sign about just how much more they have created for – they've created wealth. They haven't expropriated it. So in your world, the change in the middle class, which you talk about quite a bit in the book, what explains the growth in the middle class in that 1950 to 1980 period, or the 1914 to 1980 period?
That's an interesting and complicated question. You know, I think in a number of countries, the wars induced very large shocks to top wealthholders, and even in the U.S., even though there was no destruction on U.S. soil, the Great Depression was a major shocks to top wealthholders. So these shocks and destruction of very top wealth holdings are part of the explanation. Now, another part of the explanation are the institutions, the policies that were put in place.
How do average people get wealthy or better off by rich people doing badly? What happened there? What's the mechanism?
Oh, the simplest mechanism is that, if you have a destruction of wealth, the rate of return to wealth is going to increase. And this creates space for accumulation from people who start from less wealth or zero wealth, but who have a labor income that they can invest. So I think, there was a rise of new managerial elites and new groups of wealth accumulators in the post-World War II area, partly both in Europe and in the United States, because some of the former elites had lost their position. The other part of the explanation is the very fast growth rate of the post-war period, which allows labor income earners to accumulate. It's easier to catch up with higher wealth holders when you have a higher growth rate. So this is the R versus G logic. When you have, in the post-war period, if you take in Germany or France or Japan, you have 5% growth rate per year. So wealth accumulated in the past is less important, and the new wealth out of new savings is a lot more important. So high growth is part of it, and also a tax system that has become more progressive as compared to the pre-World War I period implies that there is the tax system is hitting less hard the middle class and the bottom groups, and harder the highest group, which again contributes to more wealth mobility and more accumulation of wealth for the middle and the bottom relative to the concentration at the top. What's interesting is that in the recent period, the growth rate, both in the U.S. and in Europe, in the past 20 or 30 years, has not been terribly good. It has actually been, quite mediocre. If the top wealth holders are rising 3-4 times faster than the average, if this had been happening forever, of course we would have a very different distribution of wealth than we have today. So when you say, this is a condition for having growth, my reaction is, except that growth has not been very good. And we've had periods in the past where growth was, if anything, better without the top rising three times faster than the average. So you can see that, you know, this is not the only possible equilibrium. I think this depends on a number of policy choices. This also depends on circumstances like, you know, wars, a baby boom, which, you know, you cannot easily affect, or actually you don't want to affect. But this also depends on policy choices, you know, the level of tax progressivity. So the period of time when you had more tax progressivity were also period of time with reduced inequality, and if anything, higher growth than what we have today. So that's one policy dimension that can play a role. I think financial deregulation has also, as I said earlier, has contributed to the rising inequality, both because of very large bonuses in the financial sector for a benefit to the real economy that has not been always very clear, and also because financial deregulation has probably contributed to actually rising inequality in access to high-yield investment.
Yeah. One thing,
these kind of institutional rules do matter a lot for inequality dynamics.
One thing we agree on is that it's not just deregulation of financial markets, but also government coddling and subsidizing of investors has certainly artificially boosted the share of the top 1%, which I'm very opposed to. And it's gotten worse in the last 5 years than it was before. One example you give in the book is increases in the minimum wage. You're talking about different policy examples. So you point out that in France, the minimum wage has risen steadily since 1970 in real terms, and it's been flat or falling in the United States. But one of the things that I worry about is I think that's a very bad way to reduce inequality. We know that in France, the unemployment rate among the least educated people has risen dramatically over that time period. So the reduction in inequality that you champion because of the French policy may simply be because people have dropped out of the labor force and aren't able to be observed in the data. Do you worry about that?
Yeah, sure. You know, it's all a matter of proportion. And, you know, I don't champion any country. You know, I love all countries. There's a lot to learn from every national experience. And, you know, I'm not here to defend any particular country or any particular policy. I think it's all a matter of proportion. You know, it's like for progressive taxation. You know, the minimum wage can be useful. But, of course, if you increase it too much, then it's going to create unemployment. So it's all a matter of proportion. What I find striking in the U.S. case is that the purchasing value of the minimum wage is now, at the federal level, is now smaller than what it was in the 1960s, which is 50 years ago. And at that time, there was actually less unemployment than what you have today. And this is quite striking. You know, if during half a century you cannot increase at all the minimum wage, at least you would expect that this is because this allows you to have a job for everyone. But in fact, no, you had more unemployment today than 50 years ago. So what are we doing exactly? Maybe, you know, I think we could increase the minimum wage in the U.S. At least by some amount. Now, I also agree with you that this is not, you cannot do that too much. So at the end of the day, you know, the main policy to reduce inequality is not progressive taxation, it's not the minimum wage, it's really education. It's really investing in skills, investing in schools. And, you know, this is what I say from page one in my book. You know, from page one in my book, I make very clear that the primary mechanism to reduce inequality in the long run is the diffusion of knowledge, the diffusion of skills, the diffusion of higher productivity. This is what can explain convergence at the international level with the emerging countries catching up with more developed countries. And this can also lead to a reduction of inequality within countries, assuming we have educational institutions that are sufficiently inclusive. And from that viewpoint, what I find particularly puzzling in the recent evolution, and in particular in the US, is that if you look at the average income of the parents of Harvard undergraduate students, you know, this corresponds to the average income of the top 2% of the US distribution of family income. So this doesn't mean that you have no student below the top two, but this means that you have very few students below the top two, and that those who come from the top 2% are sufficiently high up in the top 2%, so that the overall average, you know, when you put the students below the top 2%, those within the top 2, is as if you were to pick at random your students just from the top 2% of the family distribution of income. Now, I think this is quite far from the meritocratic ideal that we all have in mind, I believe. And, you know, I think this is a major challenge for the U.S. and also for every country. Let me say very clearly that I'm certainly not going to tell you that the French university system is the system to follow. Let me be very clear about that. So, you know, I think the U.S. has been very good at producing very efficient top universities, but have been less good at promoting equal access to higher education, and, you know, the average quality and the, you know, the bottom 50% of the U.S. population does not quite have the high quality training that one might hope. But, you know, I think no country in the world, certainly not in France or nowhere in Europe or Japan, has found the perfect system to combine efficiency with equality of access to higher education. So I think, you know, this is a major challenge for every country, and there's a lot to learn from looking at this comparative data. I think every country, including France and the U.S., often pretends to be more meritocratic than they really are. And, you know, I think, you know, people have, you know, sometimes just don't look at the data. And again, you know, this is as bad or sometimes worse in France than in the U.S. So, I mean, I'm not trying to say...
The U.S. has a very large public university system, but studies have shown that it tends to benefit high-income people as well. So that's a subsidy that is ultimately, I think, very misplaced. We also have a very poor education system before college, which I think has handicapped low-income people from low-income households. But we're almost out of time. I want to raise a couple of issues about the American data and get your response. One of the things you ignore, and everybody ignores when they look at the change in the share going to the top 1 or top 10%, say between 1980 and the present, where it starts to rise very dramatically in your data, are two things that I'd like to hear you react to. One is demographics have changed dramatically over that time period. There's an enormous increase in the divorce rate that begins in the 70s and continues through the 80s. As a result, the number of households rises much more quickly than population. And since the divorce rate is higher among low-income households than high-income households, you're going to get a rising share to the top 1 or top 10% simply for that demographic reason. Similarly, changes in tax laws encourage people to take income in the form of personal income rather than corporate income starting in 1986. So when I look at your data, the trend, although it looks quote frightening because of the increasing share, some of that is a statistical artifact. Do you agree?
No, I disagree with this statement because, in fact, you know, if anything, I think top managers are getting even more non-taxable perks, like, you know, fancy jet or big offices or fancy cars or you know, beautiful hotels and restaurants today than what they did in the 1960s or 1970s. So, you know, the view that there was as much inequality in the 60s than you have today, but that people were getting it through fancy cars, whereas at least today they are just getting cash, but they have become very virtuous regarding non-taxable perks and, you know, fancy jets. I think this is just wrong. You know, this seems to be complementary. You know, in the long run, I think, you know, you see an increase both in cash compensation and in non-cash perks and benefits. So
It's not non-cash. It's how I declare it. If I have a small business, it's now, starting in 1986, it's advantageous and for tax reasons to call that income rather than corporate profit and take it in the form of capital. So the labor share artificially rises in the 80s.
Right, but this you should see it in capital gains a bit later because, you know, when you have a lot of retained earnings within your corporation, you know, at some point you will want to get to cash capital gains out of that. And so we do take into account this through capital gains, which is a big part of the overall picture. So, you know, I'm not saying that a change in tax law do not matter for how people report income. Of course, it does matter. But if anything, I think the overall trend would look bigger if we could take into account other non-taxable forms of compensation.
React to now, that demographic point?
Regarding the demographic point, I think you're right that this can contribute to rising inequality. Although, at the very top, this is not really what's explaining the very big rise in the top shares. And also, we should not forget that when you had, when you have a married couple, sometimes you have a lot of inequality within the family, and how money is allocated, and who decides how to spend the money, and this is very complicated to look at. But there are studies in developing countries and also in developed countries showing that if you really look at how the money is spent within households, the poverty rates and inequality indexes can look very, very different. So in other words, women in married couples can be a lot more poorer than what it seems if you just divide by two the income, because sometimes the division of power and the division
of
you decide how to spend the money is not exactly equal.
But there are a lot of households. There are a lot of households in America, and they're living in the highest income areas with two high earning doctors, lawyers. That's an increasing phenomenon. I don't know whether that gets them into the top 1%. Certainly gets them into the top 10.
I agree. Yeah, I agree with that. I definitely agree with that.
One last point, then I'll let you close. You're very critical of Simon Kuznets, and I was disappointed to see that. I think he's pretty I was surprised after reading your book to go back and read his 1955 article. He's pretty cautious. I think it's his followers who implemented this Kuznets curve as a sort of inevitability that development and increases in income would lead to a reduction in inequality. Kuznets himself seems to be pretty agnostic on that.
I think you're right, and I'm sorry if I seem excessively critical with Kuznets. I think in my introduction, I tried to make clear that, I have a lot of respect and admiration for Kuznets, who was first, the first one to compute national accounts for the U.S., the first one to use income tax data to compute inequality series for the U.S., and in fact for any country. And in a way, all what I've been doing is to follow these steps, and all what I have in addition to Kuznets is more time, more data, more years, more countries. But in terms of methodology, I've just been following what he did. So, I'm sorry if I sound excessively critical. I think the problem was mostly his followers. I think he's indeed very cautious, including his 1955 article, although in his 1953 book, he's even more cautious, and I think he could have been slightly more cautious in this 1955 article as well. But the problem, as you said, were really his followers. And I think also the Cold War era, which, everybody wanted to believe in happy ends for capitalism and inequality dynamics, and felt that, if we say something bad about inequality under capitalism, we are going to favor the Soviet Union. So, at least today we don't have, this possible threat, and I turned 18 the year of the fall of the Berlin Wall. I've never had any temptation with communism, and so I think this is one of the reasons why it is possible to have a more quiet debate about inequality today than in the past. Although, sometimes some people seem to react as if we were still in the Cold War, but I think most of the time it's possible to have a more reasonable debate. And I'm very glad that I had this opportunity to have this debate with you today.
Well, some of Kuznets' followers extrapolated a trend incorrectly, and I want to challenge you, and I'll let you close with this. You're very worried. You point out correctly in the book and in our conversation that there are factors that can work against this R greater than G, but you're generally pessimistic. So if that's correct, I want you to close this and tell us whether you're optimistic or pessimistic about the future, and whether policy changes that you advocate might reverse this trend that you are worried about.
Yes, I am actually a lot more optimistic than what some people seem to believe. And, I'm very sorry if some people feel depressed after they read my book, because this is not at all the way I wrote it. And no, in fact, I think there are lots of reasons to be optimistic. You know, for instance, you know, one good news coming from the book is that, you know, we've never been as rich, you know, in terms of net wealth than we are today in developed countries. And we talk all the time about our public debt, but in fact, our private wealth as a fraction of GDP has increased a lot more than our public debt as a fraction of GDP. So our national wealth, the sum of private and public wealth, is actually higher than it has ever been. So our countries are rich. It is our governments that are poor, which is a problem, but it raises issues of organization and institution, but that can be addressed. So I think we can do better. I'm not as pessimistic as what some people seem to believe regarding the possibility to have more fiscal coordination and, you know, a more progressive tax system. I think 5 years ago, many people would have said that bank secrecy in Switzerland would be with us forever. And then it just took a few sanctions from the U.S. government on Swiss banks to make the Swiss government change their mind and accept to go into automatic transmission of bank information. So this is only the beginning of the process, but I think this illustrates that proper sanctions, and, you know, of course, it's a bit weird that European countries were not able to solve the problem by their own and had to wait for U.S. sanctions. But, you know, I want to look at this episode in an optimistic manner, which is that if we have a pragmatic approach to financial transparency and tax haven, we can make progress. And to me, the next step is, when we are going to have a transatlantic treaty between the U.S. and the European Union on free trade, I think it's important to put more than trade liberalization into this treaty. I think this is a unique opportunity to have important steps in the direction of more financial transparency, automatic transmission of bank information, a global registry for financial assets, a minimal tax on large corporations, on large multinational corporations. You know, we are putting 50% of the world GDP around the table. It's about one quarter for the US, one quarter for the European Union. So, you know, this is not a global wealth tax. This is not 100% of world GDP, but this is already 50% of world GDP. So if we cannot make progress in the direction of more financial transparency and more tax fairness, I think this will be very sad, because it's important to have a balanced approach to globalization. Everybody can benefit from globalization, but we need to have more fiscal cooperation to ensure that everybody pays their fair share. Otherwise, rising fraction of our public opinion will feel that globalization is mostly working for large multinational corporations, top wealth holders, and it's not working for them. So it's important to bring fiscal and social justice into the globalization process if we want to keep broad support for an open world economy.
My guest today has been Thomas Piketty. Thomas, thank you for being part of EconTalk.
Thank you.
This is EconTalk, part of the Library of Economics and Liberty. For more EconTalk, go to econtalk.org, where you can also comment on today's podcast and find links and readings related to today's conversation. The sound engineer for EconTalk is Rich Goyette. I'm your host, Russ Roberts. Thanks for listening. Talk to you on Monday.